I want to talk about something that's not really talked about a lot in the church today, and that's called Pentecost. And the reason for that is because Pentecost has become two different things in the church. Pentecost, a lot of people think we don't really want to deal with it, because if we deal with Pentecost, then we have to deal with Pentecostal people. If we have to deal with Pentecostal people, then we have to deal with a bunch of crazy people. Okay? I'm crazy for Jesus, man. I really am. And so a lot of people don't like to talk about it. And I can understand that, because there are a lot of Pentecostals that have given Pentecost a really bad name. But I want to kind of let you know really what it is about and why Pentecost and why that feast is there of harvest. So Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that you, Lord God, will just rain down today, Lord God, and do something absolutely powerful in our life. Don't let us leave the same person. I thank you for your word. It's already anointed. It's already life. And so I pray, Lord God, that as we hear it, as we take it in, Lord God, it will not return void. It'll do something. In Jesus' name, amen. The modern day church, for the most part, has lost the power of God. And we could tell. It's very noticeable, because we have no influence in our cities. We have no influence on the people around us. We have no influence on our families. We have moms and dads that are saved, and their kids, they're just all over the place, because something's happening. It's lost its power. And we've talked about this a lot, but sometimes we come to the cross, and because we really need forgiveness. And we want that forgiveness. But then we turn around and we go, oh, praise God, now I don't have to worry about that anymore. And I'm telling you that there's another step that you need to take, and it's a very biblical step that you need to take. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 5, he's dealing with a church. And this church looks like our modern day church. Our modern day church has a religious look to it. They go to church. They have a little church meeting. They have maybe great fellowship. They eat together. They even talk about the word a little bit. It says that they have this form of godliness. It's a form. It's something that looks like. It didn't say that they were godly, but they had the form of godliness. They went to the cross. They even believe. But then what happens? But they deny the power thereof. They deny it. Now, we've talked about this before. If you don't have the power that lies within you, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. If you don't have the power of God, how are you supposed to take it out and change a city? So they have this form of godliness. We like to go to church, and all the churches, 11 to 13,000 people on any given Sunday around here are in the churches. And so we have this form of godliness, including us. But where's the power? You see, when you deny the power, you have to ask yourself why you deny it. What are you afraid of? What are you really afraid of when it comes to the power of God? What if he did want you to stand up and prophesy? What if he did want you to do something that's a little crazy? What if he did want you to go down on the beach and just start preaching to a bunch of people? Is there something wrong with that? It says, from such, these particular people, turn away. Well, but they had the form of godliness. But you see, he doesn't want you to be a part of that church. Because it's really not an active church. It's really not a spirit-filled church. They're not doing anything. What in the world is Pentecost? Some of you may ask that. The word Pentecost, it designates the 50th day after Passover. Most people know that, which is a feast day. also known as the Feast of Weeks, or the Feast of Harvest. And I'm going to capitalize on the Feast of Harvest today, because Pentecost is all about one word. I want you to remember, if anybody ever asks you, Pentecost is about harvest. What happened at Pentecost was so that God can have his harvest. What happened at Pentecost is so that you could be a laborer for the kingdom of God. We've had so many things lately happen in this church that we're just going all over the place, from funerals to people getting sick. A girl just the other night at 1:30 in the morning, the Sinclair's daughter had a 4-inch blood clot. She's 10 years old. She lost all of, she couldn't move. She was paralyzed. She ended up at Sacred Heart. She still is Sacred Heart. And John Thomas was here this morning, her dad. But let me tell you, taking her over there, their family, I mean, they are coming to Jesus hard. Not that they didn't know him, but they're coming to him hard. They're asking, they're pleading, they're seeking, they're knocking, they're getting close. And yes, they'll cry for a minute and they're all over the place, because what are we going to do? It's our 10-year-old daughter. What's going to happen? She's paralyzed. At 1:30 in the morning, when I looked at my phone, that's when he tried to call me. He tried to call me at 3, and I got one of the nights where I didn't hear it. God have mercy on me. Called him up in the morning. Said, she's getting better. He figured out what it was. She went to surgery. Today, they're getting her up, and they're moving her around again, and she's going to be hopefully 100% whole. And we look at that. We look at that and think, oh, those doctors did a good job. Don't we? You see, do you ever just break out and say, praise God, God did that. God did that. The greatest thing that ever happened is right here, your soul being saved, your soul being saved, your soul being saved. All of your souls being saved. If you were blind and now you see, well, that's great. But your soul being saved, that's a miracle. That's a miracle. Your life being turned around. The greatest miracle. God could do all the rest of it. But see, the reason for all that is because you can't be blind and then have any control and just say, I'm going to see right now. Okay, so when that happens, of course that's God. But do you know the greatest miracle is when he actually touches the will of man? And he deals with your will. He deals with your desire. And he changes you around, literally, and takes that heart that's in there and changes it. Because now he's dealing with your will. That's the hardest thing for God to ever deal with, is your stubbornness and your rebellion. Your rebellion. There needs to come a time in our life where we start to receive the power of God. It was on this day in the book of Acts that the Holy Spirit was poured out, and 120 followers of Christ who were gathered in that upper room in Jerusalem got a portion of that power. And it was on this day that the church was born in this blaze of Shekinah glory of God. A tremendous harvest of souls that would change the rest of the world. It was a harvest. I read this statement from Jerry Vines. It said, the average Christian in the average church are somewhere bogged down between Calvary and Pentecost. Now listen to this very close. Calvary and Pentecost. They're stuck in the middle. They have been to Calvary for the pardon, but they've never been to Pentecost for the power. If you're going to write something down, that's probably the thing that I really want you to know. You went to Calvary for for the pardon. Because everybody wants to be pardoned. Everybody wants their sins to be forgiven. And nobody really wants to go to hell. So we go to Calvary for the pardon. Because we've been stubborn. We've been rebellious. We said we didn't believe in God and all that kind of nonsense. You were a lying, thieving, fornicating, you name it. And so you got your pardon. Now that we got our pardon, now we believe and we're good with our belief. But that's just the pardon. Now you need to get the power. And that power comes from the Holy Ghost. And people are afraid of that power. But without it, you got no chance to actually have a harvest. You will have no harvest. You will have no fruit to all of your labor. There will be no souls that are coming behind you when you go to heaven that you were responsible for. The only fruit you have, you'll find yourself, and I'm careful to say this, but you'll find yourself as the man that had the one talent. The servant calls him a servant. He's still a servant, but he had one talent. He took the talent and he did what? He buried it. And do you know, because he buried it, he accomplished nothing. He did nothing with what he got. What he got at Calvary, okay, he got that. It was there, but he did nothing with it. And because he did nothing with it, it said he was cast into outer darkness where there was weeping and gnashing of teeth. Think about that one. Well, I thought he got pardoned. Let me tell you something. The Holy Ghost is so important in your life. You can't do anything without it. You can go to the cross and you can believe in that, and then all of a sudden you can become a religious man. You can go to church all the time. You can do whatever you want, but all you are is a religious person. You walk around acting religious. But without a relationship with Christ, by the Holy Spirit, you've got no power. In Acts chapter 19, if you'll turn with me, starting with verse 2. I believe the average Christian is much like the Ephesians. The Ephesian believers, the ones who were in Ephesus, when the Apostle Paul came to them. And in Acts chapter 19, verse 2, he said unto them, "Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed?" Now think about that. Here he is on this marble road, and these people all excited. They understood this. They watched this. "Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed?" Since ye believed. And they said unto him, "Well, we've not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost." And he said unto them, "Unto what then were you baptized?" I want you to think about that, because that was the question. If that's the case, then what were you baptized under? And they said, "Well, unto John's baptism." Then said Paul, "John verily baptized you with the baptism of repentance." I want the pardon. "Saying it to the people that they should believe on him which could come after him." That is on Jesus Christ. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Ghost came on them. And they spake with tongues and they prophesied. So here's people that believed and they thought things were good and they got their pardon. And then all of a sudden Paul says, "Hey, have you received the Holy Ghost?" "We don't know nothing about the Holy Ghost." And he laid hands on them in Ephesus, and all of a sudden, boom, something happened in their life. Some of them began to speak in tongues. Some of them prophesied. But all of a sudden something on the inside started coming out, and it wasn't them. Now, by the way, that's why it's one of the most abused gifts too, because when you have and you feel that thing inside of you and it's powerful, so many people just walk around with all this pride that they got this thing now. Now they abuse it instead of walking in their humility. Christians do not understand the role of the Holy Spirit. They have not appropriated the power of the Holy Spirit in their own personal life for growth, for walking in it. J.B. Phillips, who gave us a familiar paraphrase of the New Testament, wrote, what we need today is, again, the wind and the flame of Pentecost. We have to have the Pentecost back in our life. We have to have the power to be able to bring in a harvest. You want to know why that there is no great... I look out there and the harvest is thick. It's everywhere. Everywhere you go. You could sit down. I could take these guys right here and we could go downtown. And by the time we came back, there's going to be 50 souls that I'll bet you're going to watch cry. They're going to cry out to God. They're going to weep because their families are just distraught, that their lives are a wreck. And then we'll come back and give you guys the testimonies on what happened. Because there's that many people. The harvest is everywhere. But the reason we don't have harvest is because we don't have Pentecost. We don't have power. Our lives are sin. Everything gets in the way. Now I'm going to be, let me tell you, I'm going to quote you, instead of quoting a bunch of stuff from a bunch of Pentecostal pastors today, I'm going to quote you from a bunch of Baptists. Just a bunch of staunch Baptists. Here's from one old Baptist preacher. Pentecost is not a denomination, but it is an experience every blood-bought child of God should receive. Praise the Lord. Those are old Baptist preachers. Notice the difference between the old and some of the new ones. A lot of the new preachers that are out there, they're afraid of it because of what it's become. And I tell them, you know what? You can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Save the baby. Okay? We're privileged to live in a generation when God is, again, I believe, going to try to grab a hold of the church. And he's going to try to do something to your life. He's going to try to start giving you the power to make sure that things are restored. I talk with so many marriages. There's marriages, and they're even in here right now. And God bless the ones that want your marriage really bad. But there's marriages where the wife or the husband is out there. They're saved. They're in church. They're worshiping this morning. And they're not even interested in their born-again believing spouse. Not even interested. They won't get a divorce. They still want to be married. But they're not even... they're not even interested in their spouse. They're not interested in reconciliation. And God is a God of reconciliation. Amen. There's no power. So in other words, we want the pardon. We want to kind of have God believe us. Lord, believe me. I'm a Christian. Believe me because I go to church. Believe me because, and the Lord says, man, you're powerless. You're powerless. The rain of the Holy Spirit is falling on a dry, very learned religious ground of our nation. And it needs a refreshing. Otherwise, we're going to get no harvest. We're ever learning, but we deny the power thereof. The power is the Holy Spirit. So we're actually denying the Holy Spirit and the purpose of the Holy Spirit in our lives to preach the gospel and to win souls for Jesus, to reap the harvest. Isn't that the Great Commission, is to go out and preach the gospel? It's God's job to be able to bring them in, but he can't find the laborers. And when I'm talking about laborers, I'm talking about spirit-filled laborers. I'm not talking about people that just believe in God. I'm talking about people that actually believe in the power of God to be able to use you to do something powerful for him. Yeah. And I'm going to give you an example. Turn to 2 Corinthians 5:17. Many of you know it. We'll probably go over 18 also, but 2 Corinthians 5:17. This is one that most people even have a problem with, because believing is one thing, but once you got the power, now all of a sudden the Word of God really comes alive to you. Now it has power to it. I can believe, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. And we talk about that. We memorize that scripture, and yet, how many testimonies do you know where, behold, all things are become new? I'm still caught up in the old. I'm still trapped. Don't you understand, Pastor? I'm addicted. You know, addiction is a hard thing, Pastor. And you know what, man? The Lord put it in us to want women. You know what I mean? Let me tell you something. Scripture is scripture. And you're going to justify why that has not happened in your life. It says that's what happened under the power of the Holy Ghost. But if it hasn't happened, then most of us will justify why it has not happened. Or we'll say, that is not necessarily what happens to everybody, Pastor Tim. It may have happened to you that way, but it didn't happen to me that way. And I'll look at you and say, why did it not happen to you that day? The most important day in your life. Salvation in the baptism of where you gave up your life for Christ. And you don't remember it. In America, that happens. In other countries, it doesn't happen that readily. But in America, we justify why we are not new creatures. The word kenos comes from a word that literally means it's brand new. It's something that did not happen before. So you're an absolutely different person. You look different. Your eyes are different. The way you carry yourself is different. Your etiquette is different. Your morals are different. You wake up in the morning, you set your feet to the ground, and you say, Lord, how can I serve you today? I can't wait to serve you today. Versus, oh, I'm a bum, I can't do this, I can't do that, and knock it off. Lord, please help me. Please. I'm depressed all the time. I understand that, but there is a power that we're missing. Verse 18 says, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. That's the harvest. It's the ministry to reconcile a person back to their God. My job is to say, hey, by the way, go that way. You want to go home? Go that way. You want to go home? I'm going to reconcile you to. I'm going to bring you right back to God. Here, there you go. There you go. There you go. Go back to God. And there's power in it. We don't have to do much. Like I said, we could go downtown, and in an hour we could come back here and give them all the testimonies of us going downtown and doing nothing but ministering to a bunch of ladies downtown. Because there's so many of them, but there's very few people that will literally submit themselves under the power of the Holy Ghost to receive it. That means you pray in the Spirit. That means you literally bow yourself before God and submit your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto Him. For that is your reasonable worship or your service. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 38 said, then Peter said unto them, now this is the promise. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. So there you go. You went to the cross. Now listen to this. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. In effect, it means it doesn't make any difference of your age. You don't have to be a special age. You don't have to be a special few. And it's not a special little blessing for this minor group of people or a little group of people. It's to all of us to receive this power. And then we make excuses of why the power doesn't work. Many of us have allowed the devil and religious tradition to rob us of the power of God. Arguments about doctrine, the Holy Spirit, Pentecost, tongues, the gifts of the Spirit. Yesterday I was cleaning my office at my house got an office in my garage. And I was cleaning my office and I found over 100 pages that I had did in a binder on the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And I started going through that and find out, when's the last time I taught on the gifts of the Holy Spirit? And I got over 100 pages just on the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And every bit of those gifts are so you can have a harvest. So you can bring people to Jesus. If you're not bringing people to Jesus, I challenge you. You may have a talent, but you're not doing anything with it. And you don't want to know the end of that story. Dr. Rice, he's a famous fundamentalist pastor. He's a Baptist preacher. Here it goes. Listen to this. There is an experience after salvation called the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I know. All saved people do have the Holy Spirit. When someone is saved, the Holy Spirit puts him into the body of Christ. But besides that, Christians ought to be filled with the Holy Spirit and this special soul-winning power of the Holy Ghost. Saved people are not always filled with this Holy Ghost. They ought to be and can be, but many are not. And that's conservative Baptist. What was the promise of Pentecost? It was the pouring out of the Holy Spirit upon all flesh, both men and women, for the purpose of bringing in a harvest. That's what it's all about. The last thing before he ascended, listen to this. The last thing that he was talking about, Luke chapter 24, verse 49. And this is going to be important so you can get it. He says, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry you into the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Endued with power. That word, endued, it means to be clothed upon. It means something that you literally settle into. It envelops you. It's like somebody is pouring something over the top of you and you are totally enveloped in it. He wants you to be endued with it. To where you can't do anything but what the Holy Ghost wants you to do. Why? Because it's in my bones. Caught up in my bones here. I gotta preach the gospel. I gotta tell somebody. Well, what's causing you to do that? That's what the Holy Ghost does. Our youth are caught up. You guys, unless you have this whole church behind you, you guys don't even stand a lick of a chance out there in the world. Because the world is trying to kick you around. It wants you to be filled with drugs and alcohol and perverseness and you name it. That's what the world wants for you. And it's going to be up in lights. It's going to like turn you on because it's going to be strobes and LEDs going off and the music that goes with it. Wow, it's all good. But let me tell you something. Unless it's the Holy Ghost, you haven't seen nothing yet. The Holy Ghost is what gives us that power and that authority. When the Holy Ghost came upon me, I can tell you what, I never went back. I don't want to go back. I ain't going back. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Praise the Lord. The purpose of Pentecost, one word portrays it basically, and it's called harvest. The feast of harvest. Having the power to bring in the souls. Talked about in Joel chapter 2. In Joel chapter 3. But I got a ton of scripture right there. But two things are necessary for the harvest. You have an early, which is a form of rain, which prepares the soil for the planting at seed time. But then it talks about the latter rain, which matures the crop for harvest. The latter rain is what prepares for the harvest. Joel 3:9, proclaim ye this among the Gentiles, prepare war, wake up the mighty men, let all the men of war draw near, let them come up, beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say that I am strong. Assemble yourselves and come, all ye heathen, and gather yourselves together round about. Thither cause this mighty one to come down, O Lord. Let the heathen be wakened to come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat. For there will I judge all the heathen round about. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get you down, for the press is full. The fat's overflowing, for the wickedness is great. Multitudes in the valley of decision. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The harvest is ripe. The harvest is ripe. I'm telling you, the world out there is wanting something that is real. And Christianity has been a hypocrisy for too long. These kids are looking for parents that are real, families that are real, that love God, where they can watch their parents literally experience God. You, all of you, were looking for the same thing. You were looking for your friends. You were looking for anybody that solidly knew Jesus. And if I asked them, just the front row, how many people did you know that were involved in your life that truly were absolute, that you know to be Bible-believing, walking Christians? And most of you are going to tell you, none. None. Some of you are blessed with the ability to find that. Hold on to it. But you see the hypocrisy of the church. A lot of people have been hurt by churches. A lot of people. I deal with that all the time. The hypocrisy in the church keeps us from crossing that thing for trust. I don't trust it. We're ruining the harvest versus going and reaping the harvest. We're ruining it. We're letting it go to waste. We're letting it go to rot. In Acts 1:8 says, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. And so you have to understand that there is power there when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Why? So you could be a witness of it. You could be a witness of it. A witness. How do you be a witness? Because it happened to me. It happened to me. And if it really did happen to me, why would I ever go back? Unless it really didn't happen. Maybe it was a good thing. Maybe you wanted out of jail. Maybe you just wanted your marriage back. Maybe you wanted to come in and just have the whole backing of the church for a little bit so you could get your thing back together. But at the end, you have to ask yourself, why did I do it? And if I did it for the right reason, watch God show up on the scene. The Bible says that you pray, but you pray amiss. You wanted to consume it upon your own lusts. A double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. You either have to believe and receive or admit that you actually don't. Think about it. I'm going to have to let you go, huh? The modern day church, for the most part, has lost the power of God. Just like Samson in the Bible, they don't know the Spirit of God has even left them. They still have a form of religion, but they don't have the power. Samson laid his hand in Delilah's lap because that felt good. He lost his power with God. He could do nothing but live a defeated life. He was blind, he was bound, and he was just grinding on that grinding wheel, going in circles, accomplishing zero. Religious tradition just robs people and churches of the power of God and just leaves them going around with that millstone in weakness, blind, and in defeat. They're blinded by the devil. They're bound up in cheap religion. Worst thing is, they don't know it. But you know what? Today can be the day of restoration. The power of the Holy Spirit will give you boldness. It'll give you confidence when you didn't have it before. Where you'll finally stand up, even when your lost loved one is out there, you'll stand up and say, you know what? I refuse to bow to this. I'm going to claim the life of that person and go after that. How many have somebody in here that is absolutely lost? You know that they're lost. Yeah, most people in here know somebody that's really, really lost is somebody that's really close to you. Have you given up? Have you backed up? Are you afraid to go to them? You see, if you truly take the power of God and you really want a harvest, then you need the Holy Ghost to do it. Because you need to be changed. You need to be brand new. You need to know what to pray, how to pray, where to pray, and when to pray. You need to know when to lay hands on people and when to, nope, I'm not laying hands on you, man. We used to have lineups of people. We used to pray for them, and we would go down the aisle, and every now and then I wouldn't pray for one, and they would get all mad. You didn't even pray for me. I didn't feel like it. Now, you see how bad that sounded? But what if you don't? Lay hands on no man suddenly. You see, there's... I could use that in outside of the context there too, but I don't necessarily feel sometimes like I need to be praying for that particular person. Maybe God has you going through something where he's just tearing you down, breaking you up to where you come before him broken and contrite, and why would I want to get in the way? So people get really mad. The Holy Ghost, and I'm closing, the Holy Ghost is a gift that could accomplish anything and everything at any time. Whatever gift that you need at the time for the harvest, that's what the Holy Ghost is there for the harvest. If you're truly eager to win that person, then you will get whatever gift is necessary to be able to lead that person to Jesus. Any one of them, because you have the gift of the Holy Ghost. Luke 11 and 13. If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them? We're going to ask him, Lord, I need that. Will you bow your heads with me? We're going to play a little music back there, and Andy kind of knows what we need. There is a power that you can have in the Holy Ghost that I believe that the church denies because they're fearful of it. If you have the power of the Holy Ghost in your life, then what is he going to require of you? What does he want of you? You're not sure that you even want to go there. I can see. As I pray, if there's anybody here that just wants to come forward and say, you know what? I went to the cross to get a pardon. But I still have yet to get the power. I want the power. I'm going for the power. And if that's you, I don't want you to be shy about it at all. I want you to come. These are the steps that the Lord's set out here for you. We call them altars, but the power is what you need to be able to make it through life, to be able to do what you need to do. I'm glad you believe. I'm excited you believe, but I want you to take that other step, and I want you to ask the Lord to completely just destroy your old flesh and bring on something that's powerful. Then I'm going to ask just some good prayer warriors. You don't have to be deacons or elders here, as long as you just feel like you really need to pray for some of these people. And if you would, can I get some prayer warriors to just come and get behind some of these people? Please. Come on, prayer warriors. They need somebody with them. Promises are true in his strength. There is nothing we can't do. Yes, we know. There are greater things in store. Thank you, Lord. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. In the name of Jesus, I just ask, Lord, now that we believe, Lord God, I pray that that same power that rose Jesus from the grave, I pray, Lord God, that you'll get a hold of these people. May Pentecost, Lord God, really hit. May the Holy Ghost hit us hard, Lord. I pray, Lord God, that that second rain, Lord God, that we're supposed to get, Lord God, to prepare the harvest, I pray, Lord God, that it would come on us right now. Give us the ability and the power, Lord God, to be able to love people that we don't ordinarily love, to go to people that we wouldn't ordinarily go to be able to go out and want to reap the harvest. Lord, I just ask in Jesus' name, that you will make sure, Lord God, that not only do we want the pardon, but we want the ability to walk the walk and talk the talk, and we can't do it without the Holy Ghost. So I pray that everyone that is up here, Lord God, would get serious about asking, I want the Holy Ghost. I want to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. I want to be put under by Jesus. And I want to make sure that when I come out of this one, that I know that I am born again. So bless all of them, Lord God, in their honesty today. May they walk out of here completely different people. And may you get the glory, all honor and praise for it, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. The rest of the congregation, if you'll just, you can leave, but if you just stretch your hands out towards them too, take some time and make sure and care about these people that are up here and pray for them. Would you do that? Because they got some serious business taking place up here.